lay out the thing, which is that there's like three main forms of capital, which is working, right? And what we learned in migration studies is that when a person moves from one country to another country, they immediately lose two of these forms of capital, almost directly. And those two are these ones, economic and social capital. You may find yourself in a situation where there's no social contacts, no social networks, maybe difficult to access job and employment. I really like what you said in your speech. When you came here, you got involved in organizations, and you became very active. And this is like a natural tendency, I would say, if you want to somehow sustain, or if you want to kind of come into something, or find your place in something, or contribute in something, or engage with something, right? So then there's this cultural capital, which is remaining, and that's kind of how my mind was thinking when I came up with this fancy title, right? And I was thinking, like, maybe if I can explore what cultural capital is, kind of understood in a national, local setting as a whole society, in terms of a migrant coming to a new place, what does cultural capital mean in that particular place? For example, Norway, Sweden, Denmark. I'm originally from the United States. I'm from Chicago. But I was born and raised in a really small town called East St. Louis. And East St. Louis is like really, I would say, like outside of like the mainstream ideas of America. You know, when I come here, I'm somehow able to use some of this social capital somehow, because people instantly, they've seen movies, they've seen TV, and they think like, oh, an American guy, The Wire, yeah, cool, right? And then there's like things to discuss. But actually, my makeup, or the way that I see America, or the way I've experienced America, is quite separate from a lot of these things that people would like to take up. That's just one dilemma of my own, right? All right, so I was reading this French guy, right? I practiced these slides last night with my fiance, and she was like, that's not how you say his name. I would say like, Badu, but I think it's like, yeah, something like this, yeah. What was that? Bonjour. Bonjour, there it is. And, it means God. Praise God. So what we see is that Bonjour has kind of, God. He's kind of come up with three forms of cultural capital. He's broken it down. And I was reading him, and I was like, okay, this dude is very deep. And I was trying to understand, what does he mean? And I'm going to do my best to try to tell you what I think he means, right? The first state is the embodied state, which is, of course, like in the form of this long-lasting disposition of the mind and the body. And I have another slide to follow, so I'm going to go deep into that. And then this is the objective state, which is more of like a material way of looking at cultural capital. And it has like two different avenues that you take from how you look at materials, or how people own materials, right? And then there's the institutionalized state, which is mainly emphasized in the sense of education or professional skills. What me studying in the theater, name a big theater school in Sweden, for example. I actually don't know. This school. So because I've studied here, when I leave, I have this degree that I can take on with me, and then this somehow informs about my cultural capital, right? So it says a lot about my capacity to come into the world of theater and the stage, right? So to try to break it down, the embodied state is something which is not transmissible, but it's something that's rather impressed upon a person, right? It's like the the codes, the values, the things that you learn, maybe from family units or from communities. It's the learning and the thinking and how you how you navigate yourself in society, how you become socialized, right? Me, black man from the US, what do I do? What's my movements like? How do I respond? How do I react, right? This is something that is that can't be really transmissible in a sense of economy, but it is like a legitimate competence, right? Like this guy knows, he knows what it is. It's also interesting to say that it's something which is acquired over time, either consciously or passively, right? And when I came up with the title, I was trying to think like, okay, this is how cultural capital is understood in a national setting. And it's a very like homogenic way of like approaching what cultural capital is. And that's something to remember as we go through, right? I'm thirsty. All right, the objectified state, as I said, is like the materiality of the thing. And this could be in the form of writings, paintings, and it's also about how a person is connected to those objects and those things. So if I am a collector of paints or artwork, then obviously these things can wage a type of economic value, right? Or it could be that I'm connected to these paintings, but these paintings are somehow symbolic to me and who I am because I understand the embodied state associated with creating these paintings, right? So it becomes something that's either symbolic in the sense that it wages more cultural capital, or symbolic in the state in the sense that it is added to some economic capital. And I've even found some things, like some funny YouTubes, like where this objectified state is also kind of like including like what kind of car you drive, have a Mercedes, like what you wear, how you look, and how you present yourself. And I used to live in Japan, right, for like 1.5 years. And I noticed that all the students in Japan, they used to carry their pens in this like little pouch bag, you know? That was like one of the first things I noticed when I moved there for some reason. It was so neat and like, everything was so like, I have my pouch bag, here are my pens. And I never carry pens in a pouch bag, but then I thought like, oh, this is like, this is like some cultural capital right here. Like this is something that is like distinguishing itself from how I understand carrying my pens and then how they are carrying pens. And I thought like, maybe I can learn from it or maybe I can take it on. I don't know what you do with it. So then the institutionalized state, and this is like, as I said before, it's kind of like straightforward, right? It's like what academic qualifications you have and what professional qualifications do you have and like, how those qualifications are understood in the larger social world and social context. And it's cultural capital, which is measured in a qualitative and quantitative way, right? So if you take those ideas about cultural capital and you think about this is the general understanding of how culture is developed, maintained, continued, and then you think about a migrant who comes into a setting where these things have been embedded and established, then I think that there's room for migrants to somehow take a disposition in what is happening. And that disposition is somehow what I see was being developed here in the community theater, right? And also in my own experiences and cultural practices. So how does a migrant see the society in terms of this cultural work, this cultural business? If there's an immediate loss in economic capital and there's an immediate loss in the social aspects, then of course like culture becomes something that we could then use to bargain and network and kind of like figure out something, like how to turn what we have as cultural resources into that capital. And because we know that capital is all interlinked, that if you can achieve a type of cultural capital, then perhaps you can kind of overflow into
economic capital and the social capitalist,
right?
And I'm trying to understand like that transformation or that play or that hard work actually that it takes to penetrate into those different things. So what I have here is that migrants engage in position taking from the point where you begin to strategize how to employ like my skills, how to employ all that I know, all that I am, all of my qualifications into some new setting. And the last few days here in this conference, I think that this is what this conference has been about, right? Like trying to strategize, like we as minority community theaters in our respective countries have realized that we maybe don't access the same amount of cultural capital as established national theaters already possess, but how can an alliance begin to enrich our own cultural capital by use of transforming or converting cultural resources into capital? And the ability to do that, I think, was really good with you giving us Niels. Like, it was very like tangible things, like 8 things. Like, this is, and I was thinking like, okay, I'm gonna talk about it, but I actually don't know. I'm trying to figure out myself how to penetrate, how to do these things. But this was a really good example of like, these are some kind of practical ways in which you can access the cultural capital. But the main objective is to be recognized and that your cultural competences can be circulated and interlinked, as I said before, with social and economic capital. And the main point that I want to drive here is that if you kind of understand how the social capital is like working and the cycle, and it's repeating and it's continuing to develop art as we see it, culture as we see it, and it's not including or thinking about anything outside of those confines, then the migrant will come and the migrant will somehow disrupt this linear understanding of what the cultural capital has been or what it is. And this is done by creating networks and new methods of functioning, new methods of validating one's skills and so forth. So to kind of bring it away from Bajou, this like area that I'm like, whoa man, you're deep. I want to try to put it in a real life sense of what I actually mean, right? And I'm gonna talk a little bit about myself, because this here is a project that I established about 5 or 6 years ago in Chicago, and it's called Passport Carriers. And what I have been thinking about is, how can I create access for young Black Americans who lived in the South Side of Chicago and very excluded from all of what Chicago meant, all of what Chicago is kind of about, you know? And this idea was that maybe if I can inspire young people to get passports, like that it would somehow contribute to the psychological and eventually physical mobility and a better understanding of other places, that just because I live in this one scenario, in this one area, that I am still connected to the world, and I can also bypass a lot of the forces that keeps me excluded from the society just by going to another place, just by tasting more life, just by increasing human capital, maybe learning a new language, experiencing art and culture in other places, right? If you could think of this project as kind of like my cultural resource, right? This is like what I have in my bag, if you say, and I'm coming to Sweden. My sort of task has been to make this experience somehow convertible into the cultural setting here in Malmö, right?
And how do I tap into this resource and how do I re-strategize what this project could mean in terms of mobility and passports and reframing it in a sense that it works here in Malmo. So, just briefly, I want to say a little bit about the project, which was the reason why I wanted to do this is because less than 30% of Americans own passports, right? Just from the very front. And you can imagine that that number is much smaller amongst this particular group that I have been working with. I moved from East St. Louis to New Orleans. The reason I moved is because I realized that if I wanted to be successful in life, I couldn't do anything in East St. Louis. If I put on a suit and went out, like I'm gonna go get a job today, there's no businesses, there's no establishments. So I moved to New Orleans for education. When I was in New Orleans, Hurricane Katrina came, and then I was in this kind of forced migration and I had to move outside of New Orleans. And then I found myself in a limbo state. What do? Do I wait for the university to open back up and sit in East St. Louis, the town that I had like, basically like, I gotta get the hell out of here? Or do I try to seek out new opportunities? And I did, and that's why I ended up in Japan with all the fancy pen pouches and so on. I remember, I'm just sharing a story before I go further into this, because there's more meaning into this, actually. I remember once in Japan, in Tokyo, in the nightclub, with friends, on the dance floor, and I was having a great time, right? And I just started to cry on the dance floor. I was like 19 years old, and I was just like crying, but I was happy as hell, and I was sad too, right? And my friends are like, why are you crying? I'm like, because I'm not supposed to be here. Music's loud, I'm like, what? I said, I'm not supposed to be here. And I'm like, what do you mean? I'm just not supposed to be here. Everything about the social, economic setting in East St. Louis, the education, the systematic race issues in America says that you should either go to prison, right, or be dead. And I find myself in Tokyo, and I'm studying medicine, and I'm on the dance floor, and I got a fancy, like, pin pouch. And I'm like, you know, I'm the man, right? And I'm thinking, like, okay, how have I been able to crack outside of these, like, very, like, large structures that says who I am? It tells me about my identity. It tells me what I should embody. It tells me who I should be culturally. Everything. It's already made up for me. And I thought that the one thing that actually has been the activating tool was my passport. Because before I even had my passport, I hadn't even thought of myself as an American citizen. Not once had I thought, like, yeah, I'm American. Yeah. Never. But then, when I got this document, and it was like, boom, in my face, Keenan Allen, the United States of America, and everywhere that I go in the world, people would treat me accordingly to how they think of America, how they see America, how they perceive it. Then I had a big job now, because everything that I know about America is not these discussions and these things that people are meeting me with. Now I gotta know about New York, I gotta know about LA, I gotta be talking about, you know, the new hipster scene in San Fran, and like, you know, it's crazy, right? But what I have been offering myself was an opportunity to meet and learn who I am, actually, in a reflection, a larger reflection of a global community, right? What is my identity, and what do I mean in a larger context, you know, not only in reference to the issues that I was facing in the United States. And I wanted to offer this same opportunity to other people who were growing up in communities like mine, right? I wanted loads of black kids dancing on the floor in Tokyo crying. That's what I wanted to do, right? So to go further into it, we were able to work directly with five young students, all received passports, all were in high school. We went on a 2-week trip to Documenta 13, which is a international art festival that happens every 5 years in Kassel, Germany. This was made possible by Yasta Gates, who's a great friend of mine. He's an artist, activist, and his foundation, which is called Rebuild Foundation. The short-term results were that we made a documentary film from the beginning to the end of the project. And it was the guy's first time trip outside of the US. And they all received this passport. And in the long term, I like to think that it worked in terms of self-confidence and empowerment. And it sort of offered an experience outside of ordinary life, a moment to kind of like realize that the things that I face in this immediate circumstance can be much wider. I can kind of uncrack these things by simply moving. Mobility, very important. After the project, I moved to Malmo. I myself must do the thing that I am like trying to preach, right? Like I have to move. I have to be transnational. And this is like my mind map that I have been doing with my good friend Miriam, who's here. And it's like trying to strategize, to go back to what we were discussing about how cultural capital was working, right? How do I take Chicago and all of the opportunities and the things that were established there through passport carriers and translate it into something in Malmo, keeping my focus on migration and integration, developing new community supporters. This is Sarda, but we got like 2 more theaters to add here now, right? And it's like this mind web for trying to transmit the things that you are bringing in your bag into a new space. And I think that is, again, what is happening here amongst the minority community theaters. So, migrants exercise agency by creating new forms of migrant-specific cultural capital within the countries that they live in. They also are working to create mechanisms of validation, how to validate the work that was done before and put it into the new setting. So the work with passport carriers and the film toured in Europe, we went to Berlin, right? We won a film festival. Then I've kind of used that to like go to the Inter Art Center and say, hey, I'd like to show my film here. It's won this, it's documented. Okay, great, now I'm showing my film, right? And then, in 2015, we have like a lot of young people who moved to Sweden, which is fantastic. And then I'm able to say like, hey, I've been working with youth and like, I know how these things work. Then I can get a job with the Malmö Stad. So it's like utilizing some cultural resources, turning it into cultural capital, and then from there, social capital and accessing economic capital. This pattern or this like process that happens, this creative process, is the process that I think that we have to really like identify for the theaters, like how are we going to creatively connect and creatively create a process that is going to continue the social practices around the theater as we have, and also continue the mission of accessing the culture. So, I thought that I can leave my talk with some questions. And I hope that these questions can be reflected over lunch and in the workshop. And I hope that I have offered some other perspective, maybe some theory to what is happening. And I'm very grateful for this opportunity, guys. Thank you.
Questions for Keenan?
My reflection, maybe a reflection.
Yeah?
Yes.
students really could recognize when I go back to my community in France. And I'm not recognized as a Swede, I'm not a blue eyes, I'm not a white woman, and I'm back in Morocco, I'm not recognized here as Moroccan, because somehow I'm seen as, well, I'm just here passing by. So carrying a passport by itself is defined. Your identity is also depending how others are looking at you. And there is also a matter of power, who is defining what, that we cannot forget when you talk about culture. Because it seems to be that people with the power making decisions are the one defining who we, maybe white or black or minority, what are our competence, what are our culture, if they are valuable, if they are really credible or not. So I start thinking it really matters what passport we carry.
Absolutely.
Or how the others look at us.
Yeah.
From their maybe from their superior stage, we are superior than you, we can define you. You can't define who I am, I define myself.
Yeah.
So that made me think, and I'm really thankful for it.
Yeah, that's great. Like, I can feel a reflection back, because I don't want to sound superficial in my presentation. The way that I'm thinking about the project in Manama is actually much more critical thinking and more like involving these matters around the facilitation of the passport as a device which is either creating limitations or access. And I recognize that there are so many people who carry passports that perhaps mean nothing in the sense of mobility, right? And because of that, I didn't add it in the slides because it's just a little bit too much for the occasion. But I'm trying to think about how to establish a local passport for the city of Malmö, which would work towards inclusion. You know, like a passport that would be something that would create community amongst everyone who's living in the city, but also something that is like able to identify the invisible borders that are also existing around culture and social life. So we should talk more, because I think, I'm not like this like flower guy, like, yeah, get the passports and travel, man, it's great. I also understand, like, it's a very controversial device, and that's why I want to talk about it. I want to talk about it because it is controversial, and I want to challenge it. I want to challenge how it is managing people. When you go to the airport, non-Europeans stand over here, Europeans over
exactly.
here. I hope that one day we look back and we think this is the most ridiculous thing that we've ever done, right? And I can go on and on, so we can talk.